Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Calvary Chapel of Prescott on this really special evening, isn't it? A special night. Have you had a chance to reflect on what it means, on why we're here tonight on a Friday night of all times? Why? Why is it that we as Christians gather together? Did you know that today, tonight, Friday evening, worldwide, about 600 million Christians gather together on a Friday evening? That's right. We're a tiny piece of that, but we are here. It is a special time for sure, and here's what we're going to be doing this evening, okay? You'll notice that the worship team, of course, is up here. You don't have to stand. I see some of you doing it, which is so precious. I mean, it just shows you. It shows you these folks and how much a part of the body of Christ they are here. What we're going to do tonight, if you've been here in past services for Good Friday, is we're going to have the worship team up here through the entire service, because we're going to follow Jesus' path to the cross. And throughout that, we're going to have some special worship songs, just times to reflect. We're going to be taking communion together tonight, but it's going to be sort of at the beginning as opposed to the end of our service. So that'll be very sweet as well. So it's good to be able to remember, huh, our Lord and what he did for us on the cross. Before we get into our first song of worship, would you bow your heads? Let me just pray before we begin. Lord, we are so thankful for how you willingly went to the cross for us, how you willingly died for us, how you did it because of love, how you did it, Lord, because we were the joy set before you. We are thankful, Father, that you gave your only begotten Son. And Lord, we are here together as the body of Christ to remember, Lord, to reflect, God, to just be in awe of you, just to be in awe of the fact that we serve a God of such grace and God of such love. Lord, we pray for your anointing over this evening together. We pray just for your blessings, and we pray, God, that you will be glorified through it all. We love you, and we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
King.
speaking to my sons, and they were sort of happy. They happened to be in the sanctuary right now, but they were sort of happy, and I kind of asked them what was going on, and this is more or less the answer. Well, today is Friday. And I was thinking, what's the big deal? You got school to do, go do school. And it turns out that on Friday, they have less classes than any other day of the week. So they finish school earlier, that means video games earlier, that means getting in trouble earlier. It's all of those things put together. Fridays, you remember Fridays when you were a youngster, maybe when you had school and then you knew that the weekend was coming. For me, it was what? Saturday morning cartoons, remember that? Saturday morning cartoons. There was the Sunday sleep-in. Friday's a big deal. Friday might be the end of the work week for some of you. Friday. Of course, pondering Friday and the fact that Christians, we call Friday good. Good Friday, this particular Friday, the Friday before Easter, we call it Good Friday. And the reason we call it good, well, some I have heard call it gruesome, but we call it good and we maintain that it is a good Friday, don't we? Because Jesus, he willingly went and died on the cross for our sins. Yes, the death was a gruesome one, no doubt. Nevertheless, it was something very special. And what we're going to do is consider it, as I already said before, but we're going to take the path, so to speak, with Jesus. I want to start right at the beginning of that week when Jesus comes into the town or the city of Jerusalem, Passover week. You might remember what he does. Jesus rides into the city of Jerusalem on a donkey. If you were here on Sunday, Palm Sunday, Pastor Tim spoke about the fact that the Lord did come into town and what all of that meant while he was a donkey. Remember that the Romans were in charge. These were the Jews. They were a proud people. They were people who wanted to rule themselves, but they weren't ruling themselves. In fact, some would call them second-class citizens. They would be the ones who actually had to pay taxes to Caesar. They were the ones who didn't like the situation that they were in. And here's what they were praying about over and over, literally for hundreds of years. God, rescue us. It was God, take these Romans, take them and basically destroy them. They knew the prophecies. If you read in the Old Testament, there were prophets who said, one day, Zechariah, 500 years before this time, said, there will be a king. There will be a Messiah who will come. He will be powerful, and he will be the one to save you. And the people were like, Lord, now? Lord, now? Lord, now? And they kept on praying sort of that prayer. And then they noticed a sort of a humble little carpenter from Nazareth. And this man started doing things that they had never seen done before. His name was Jesus. And this man started doing things like multiplying fish and bread in order to feed thousands and thousands of people. He was able to go to sick men and he was able to say, you know what, rise and be healed. And the people just rose, healed. He was able to take blind men and say, you know what, now you will see and do whatever it was that he did. And they saw. He was able to speak wisdom. They said, man, who is this man who speaks these words? And they thought, wait a minute. Maybe this is the man. Maybe this is the one right here. And so many of them start to follow him. Many of them say, yes, indeed, this is that one, our Savior. This is the one who is our King. This is the one who was prophesied. Oh, God, thank you. Zechariah said he would come in to the city of Jerusalem. He said, praise, oh, daughter of Zion. Sing praises as he will come in righteous. He will come in victorious. So in your New Testaments, of course, You notice we made it a little dark, so you don't have to pull out your Bibles and try to read when I take you through these scriptures. But in Mark, it tells us that many in the crowd, remember now, Jesus is coming in to the city during Passover week. And it says that many in the crowd spread their coats on the road ahead of Jesus, and others cut leafy branches in the fields and spread them along the way. It says he was in the center of the procession, and the crowds all around him were shouting. They weren't whispering. They weren't saying, maybe this is the guy. They were saying, praise God. Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Bless the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Praise God in the highest heaven. Now, one thing, he didn't come riding in on a stallion. Because, you know, stallion, that was the war horse. You wanted a king to come in and you wanted him to defeat the enemy, he rode in on a stallion. That's what David did. He rides in on a donkey. Yeah, he kind of passed over that. They said, okay, still, he must be the one. So they let him go into town, obviously, and many of them are following, like, come on, look at those Romans. But instead of going into the town of Jerusalem, into the city, and kicking them out, or destroying the headquarters of the Jerusalem or of the Roman army, he goes to the temple, the Jewish temple. And you know what he does at the Jewish temple? He doesn't pat them on the back and say, oh, God loves you. He overturns tables and he drives people out and he says, my house will be the house of prayer. Remember, he goes, but you have made it the den of thieves. Is that what the king of the Jews was supposed to do? Drive out Jews from his own temple? No, he wasn't, but he did it. Then, instead of talking about how unfair Roman law was, you know what he told people? He said, you obey it. He said, you pay taxes. You pay to Caesar what is due to Caesar. He said, you are to be the ones who are to obey these. And he started speaking about the things that the Jews are supposed to do as, well, being in the place that they were. He kept on telling them to obey God or to be more righteous. He kept calling them out. Where was the king? Right? They wanted a political king. They wanted a political savior. But this carpenter, he kept on being a spiritual man. He kept on saying things. They were mighty wise. But he kept on saying it that way. And so people over these days, you know, as the days go by in this Passover week, they start shaking their head. They don't nod anymore. Because when they're putting palm branches down, they're nodding and screaming and yelling, yes, praise God, Hosanna. But now they're going to start shaking their heads like this. And their smiles are going to turn into grit teeth. They're going to say, hey, this man's not a king. This man's worthy of the death of a traitor. Who is this man? Those who cried out, Hosanna, would cry out, crucify him. And here's what you and I can look back on with hindsight and say, wow. No, wait a minute. If you were there, you would say, wow. Jesus knew that these people who loved him in the beginning were going to hate him so much that they wanted him to die a gruesome death. Did Jesus turn the donkey around and go out? No, maybe to spend the night a couple of times at Mary's house. But other than that, no, he came back in because he understood what he was there for. He understood his purpose. And Jesus knew that he needed to accomplish that purpose. What a king. Hosanna for sure. What a savior. How amazing it is and how appropriate it is that we call tonight Good Friday. We're about to go to the upper room. But just before that, we'll have our team lead us into it with a worship song.
Each suffering I do dream. Each work it I do see. Lead to my Savior.
Of Jesus interacting with people and getting those heads shaken at him and probably some fists pointed his way. And Jesus, though, of course, focuses on his disciples. Now it is what we call the upper room discourse. Jesus finds his disciples find an upper room, and Jesus takes his men up there. And it's a time of intimacy. It's a time of just sharing the love of God. It's a time for them to interact. It's a sweet time. In fact, the Passover meal, the meal that they were celebrating, the upper room meal that they were sharing one with another, was a time of sweet fellowship. And Jesus used it as the opportunity really to teach them some of the grandest lessons that he had ever taught to his men. But in the midst of that, there was a betrayer. And his name was Judas. It was a disciple that Jesus had chosen from 3 years prior, but the Bible tells us in John chapter 13 that as the evening meal was in progress, the devil had prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. And it was for 30 pieces of silver. I mean, he wasn't even, you know, a good negotiator. 30 pieces of silver was all he wanted to betray Jesus. But notice that the credit there went to the devil, who would have been happy because the devil got a bargain price for betraying the Son of God. And we also know why the devil did it. Because he thought that if he could get rid of this nemesis of his, Jesus, boy, all of his problems would be gone. And so he got that plan in motion, but little did he know that actually it was a plan that God had already set in motion, and that the devil himself was simply a part of that plan unfolding. Plan that God would become a man, a plan that said he would live a sinless life, a plan that said this God who lived a sinless life would fulfill prophecy after prophecy after prophecy, all the way up until dying for the sins of mankind. Satan didn't manipulate Jesus, did he? No, he didn't. Jesus was actually the one who knew what was coming next. Jesus was the one who followed a divine plan that the world would need to be saved through him. In Revelation chapter 13, by the way, it does tell us that Jesus was the Lamb slain since before the creation of the world. Did Satan get a bargain price? Well, yeah. But I'd say it like this. Actually, God got the bargain price. And the plan unfolded. So there they were in the upper room, and they were having their interaction, and Judas, the one who betrayed Jesus, washed the feet of his servants. Jesus humbling all of us by telling us what it means to serve. And they begin to eat, and Jesus does something very startling. He takes the bread, which is a common thing in their meal. He takes their wine, which is a common thing in their meals. And he says, gentlemen, I'm going to make these represent something totally different. In fact, I'm going to rock your worlds. That's in the Rog translation of the Bible, by the way. I want you to know what these are. I want you to know what these mean. And he takes this bread and he implements what's known as the Lord's Supper, what we call communion. It's what we're about to partake of in just a moment. But what Jesus does is he says, I want you to look at this bread. And the bread would have been coarse, it would have been rough, it would have been torn in pieces. And then, of course, the cup of wine would have been crimson, more or less the color of blood. And he would say, these things are going to now represent something that will change the course of history. I know what's coming. You guys don't know yet, but one day you will. And what I'm going to want you to do is time after time after time, I want you to come together. And with these elements, I want you to remember what's about to happen. That's what we'll do. We'll take the elements. We're going to remember what's about to happen. So with that said, how about this, please? Let's have the worship team again lead us in a song as the servants will be coming forward to take the elements, to take the elements and to pass them out. And by the way, the cups are stacked this time, okay? There's a cup with a little cracker in it, and there's a cup with the juice in it, and they are coming together, so pull them out together and be careful when you open them up. But don't take them. Wait until I lead us in taking those, okay? Servants, you may come forward now. Disciples were holding this coarse bread, unleavened bread. It was torn apart into pieces. It represented his yet to come broken body, Jesus' body. You have in your hand a cracker, and of course it represents that broken body of Jesus. That's what this is. Of course, we know it. It represents it. Jesus then showed them that wine, that cup, and again told them that it represents his blood and that through it, the sins of men would be forgiven. I'm going to read that passage. Listen to what Jesus speaks to his disciples. It says, now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread. And after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take. He said, eat, because this is my body. And what the men thought, we don't know, but they would have definitely been perhaps taken aback. He said, take, eat, this is my body. It says that he took the cup. This cup that you have is what we will take in just a moment. It says, when he gave thanks, he said, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant. This is my blood of the promise that is now to be fulfilled. You'll understand it, this would be Jesus more or less saying. You'll understand it once it comes. But this is going to mean everything to you. This is going to change everything for you. He said, this is the blood of my covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus was foretelling and preparing them for something that would definitely change the history of the world. Something that would change the course of, I guess, every human life. You're looking at one of those lives that was changed because of what Jesus did through his body and through his blood. And I know I'm looking at many of you the same. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. For those of you who you have this and you've been touched by what it is that Jesus did in that new covenant, you close your eyes. I want you just to reflect on the words that Jesus spoke as if you were there in the upper room. And this is the Lord telling you to take that bread and remember this is what it means. To take that cup and to remember this is what it means. And it would change the course of history. Lord, we remember together. We are in awe together. Lord, that you did what you did humbles every one of us. We are thankful for your willingness to go and have your body broken for us. We are so thankful that you bore the cross. You endured the cross and that you spilled your blood from it. And Lord, so now together as the body of Christ, we take these elements remembering with the bread and with the cup. Church, you may take now. Let's take it together. How sweet. How sweet that is to be able to do. So they took it. Gave them the shivers like it did me, I don't know, but they took it together. And there were some more things that happened, that transpired there in the upper room as they ate, but eventually they knew that they had to go. Jesus knew that it was time to go. And so with the elements out of their hands, so to speak, they leave, they sing a hymn, it says. And then they left the upper room and they walked to the Mount of Olives. They needed a place, Jesus needed a place to go and pray. And so he goes to a garden. This is the Garden of Gethsemane. And Luke tells us that he left his disciples to the side, particularly Peter, James, and John. And it says, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. It says, in being in agony. What a word, agony there. It's utter pain in the deepest, deepest part of your spirit. Agony means pain. It says, in being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. All the more almost begging the Father. Father, I know what's coming, but could there be any other way? Because if there's any other way, show me and I will go that way. Father, any other way, It says in agony, he prayed it, and he prayed it almost to the point of begging. And then it says, through all of this agony, do you remember what happened? It says that he started sweating drops of blood. That's what it says. His sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Was his pain heavy? Indeed, it was. He knew what was coming, and he begged, but he understood that it was necessary. He said, not my will, but your will be done. So after this agonizing prayer, after blood literally coming out of his sweat pores and falling to the ground, it says that Jesus came back to the disciples and he found them sleeping. But he woke them up and he said, sleep and take your rest later on. You see now, the hour is at hand and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. So the plan comes to fruition. Before we see what happens now in the arrest, in the trial, in the torture, we reflect on the agony. We reflect on what it is that the Lord was calling out to and yet said, not my will, but yours be done. With that said, we'll have our team lead us in another song and then talk about what happens next in Jesus' final hours. Matthew tells us in chapter 26 that while Jesus was speaking to his disciples, it was at that time that Judas came and kissed his master. And that was the signal to the arresting party, the soldiers and those rulers who had come. That was the signal that this was the man to take him away for his so-called trials and his ultimate execution. And it says there in Matthew 26 and verse 56, then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Jesus at this moment now being totally alone. Jesus who had spent the last 3+ years loving those men with all that he was, teaching them, taking them through their life experiences that they would need to know for the years to come. And in the matter of just a few minutes, they fled. It says, then all the disciples deserted him and fled. So Jesus was arrested. He was taken into custody, so to speak. And the Bible tells us that he was essentially ferried from one so-called trial to another. It's what they call kangaroo court. It was definitely not something that we would think of as true justice. In fact, it wasn't true justice. He was taken to the Jewish courts, the Jewish rulers. Now remember, they hated him. He came into Jerusalem 5 days earlier, 6 days earlier, but he had betrayed them, so they thought. He was supposed to be their conquering king, but instead it seemed like he wanted to conquer them. And so they wanted him executed. The problem was that in that Roman law, this was one of the things they hated, they couldn't sentence a criminal to death. They didn't have the authority of execution. And so they had to take the criminal and basically seek the Roman court, hoping that the Roman court would sort of confirm their conclusion, find the guilt, and say, yes, indeed, this man should be executed. So that's why they would ferry him off to the Roman courts. And once he was there, you would read in your scriptures, boy, things were certainly not easy for the Lord. He went before the Roman governor Pilate, Pontius Pilate, who was a ruler who was not very popular with the Jews in that day. In fact, he wasn't too popular anywhere. Pilate knew of this Jesus, and you knew that he didn't want to have anything to do with him. He didn't want Jesus. He didn't want to deal with Jesus at all. And he actually got to a point where he found Jesus completely innocent. You know, what were these absurd allegations? What was this stuff that they were telling him? Well, Jesus was, what, an insurrectionist? He wanted to somehow become the king over this place. You know, Pontius Pilate said, no, I see nothing wrong here. But the Jews, oh, so much pressure on him. They were bloodthirsty. And so eventually when Jesus came to Pontius Pilate, he said, okay, you thirst for blood, I will give you blood. And that's when he sent him off, Jesus off, to be scourged. Certainly that would have to satisfy them. Scourging, the whipping, with a tool known as a cat of nine tails, a whip. But it was a horrific tool of torture. Some of you might have seen pictures, perhaps you know, that it was a whip that was fashioned with these straps that came out of it, and in these straps they embedded rock, or they embedded glass, or they embedded sharp objects in there. Bone. They would take bone and they would embed pieces of bone in these leather straps. And it says, we're told historically that when the Romans would whip a man with this executioner's tool, a torturer's tool, that it was always done by a professional Roman soldier. The difference between the Romans whipping and the Jews whipping was this. The Jews, they were sort of limited. They limited themselves to 40 less one. In other words, 39 lashes is what the Jews would sort of implement on a man, and then they would stop. The Romans were under no such legal requirement. And so the Roman soldier, he had free rein. There were two rules that the Roman soldiers definitely lived by when they were whipping their prisoner. One, they couldn't kill him. And number two, they couldn't let him pass out. Now, when you would see the setup there, you would always notice either some sort of a basin or a bowl or a cup, and it would contain salt water. And the reason why they would have that is because as the soldier would whip the prisoner, if he was about to pass out, they would take it and pour it on the wounds of the prisoner. And that would keep him, of course, because of the horrific pain, it would keep him from passing out. And so Jesus was there, stripped naked, with his back skyward, stretched out. And this professional torturer went to work. And it is said that every time one of those blows come down, it literally rips apart a man's flesh. And the more that he's whipped, the further and farther down that whip goes, to the point of exposing bone or skeleton. And this was the reason why it was often said that many, many men wouldn't even survive. Even if the soldier wasn't supposed to kill his prisoner, he often did. That was how horrific this was. Generally speaking, the criminal, he would always confess. Basically, the pain was so horrific that whatever he was accused of, he would confess and say, I did it. That's it. I'm done. If they were alive to do so. Jesus, it says he spoke not a word. Can you imagine? He's accused of basically insurrection, trying to be the king, and he speaks not a word. And what it tells us is that basically Jesus endures that torture. He takes it all the way, probably just shy of death, because these professionals, they were still pretty good. And they would be able to recognize, okay, one more blow is going to take this man, so let's stop here. So you have to remember that when Jesus is taken away from this, he is on, so to speak, death's door. Could this blood, like, appease the crowd? Remember, they're shouting, crucify him, kill him. And crucifixion being a horrific form of execution. Pilate saying, if they see this blood, if they see all that this scourging does to a man, you know, surely they'll say enough. And so Pilate takes them before the crowd. And he tells them, look, the man. And they continue to yell, crucify him. He says, what shall I do with this man? And they yell out, crucify him. They say, crucify him. And so Pilate takes water. And he washes his hands in front of the crowd and he says, I am innocent of this man's blood, and sends Jesus away. Crucifixion. This is where Jesus was going to next. Perhaps you know the story of what happens to Jesus as he's mocked and that crown of thorns. And boy, just the horrific things that were told happened to him. We know that he's forced to carry the beam that's going to ultimately hold him up there on the cross. He has to carry it up the road to that hill called Calvary, that he would take it through that, the Via Dolorosa, the song that we just sang, that he would have to do it publicly and that he was barely able to. In fact, the Bible says there were times with his arms, with his hands up to his sides, it was so heavy, he was so weakened on death's doorstep that he would literally fall over, but with nothing to break his fall, so he would fall flat on his face. And eventually a man named Simon, a Cyrene, came along, and he was told, you help this man, Jesus. You take this up to Calvary. And we know that that's what happened. And so as he got up there, the soldiers were professionals. It was said that by this time, the Romans had executed by crucifixion some 30,000 Jews. So they were good. And the way they hung a man to the cross, I don't want to get too much into it, but you know, the spikes were driven through, it says, his hands to keep him held to the cross beam. His feet, one laid on top of the other, and a spike driven through to hold him, his legs to the vertical cross beam. And then he was hoisted up, and of course, the cross secured to the ground. And that's where the man would then have to endure his torture and his execution. Because of the way that the criminal was hanging on the cross, it was said that by and large, the actual means of death was suffocation. There would come a point where he would no longer be able to inhale because of the muscles here in his chest becoming too weak or limited. Eventually, he would just give up and he would suffocate to death. The men didn't talk much. The criminals, they didn't talk much. They were trying to save their air. They were trying as much as they could to survive. And yet the Bible tells us that Jesus made what are called seven significant statements from the cross. Maybe you've even heard sermons that are dedicated just to the seven statements that Jesus makes from the cross. Just the fact that he makes seven statements is pretty significant in and of itself. But of course, we know the words that he speaks. You can look through the Gospels. Wow. The first thing he says, Luke tells us in Luke chapter 23, Jesus said, "Father, kill them." No. If that was me, I'd say, "Father, kill them," but that's not me. That's Jesus. He said, "Father, forgive them." Like, are you kidding? The first words that Jesus utters while he's having a hard time even breathing, while he's been beaten nearly to death, right there at death's door. And the first thing he does is cry out, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." That's right. The first thought was for others. A demonstration right up to his death of who Jesus was and why he was there for the sake of others. Jesus cries out, of course, within earshot, "Father, forgive them." A couple of Good Fridays in the past, I gave a message about the Roman soldier who would have been responsible for Jesus' crucifixion. And how blown away would he have been to hear those words come out of Jesus' mouth first. "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." He demonstrates love to them. Now, remember as well that in the area where Jesus was crucified, we're told that he was crucified with a criminal on either side of him. He was crucified between two criminals. And you know, the story is that these two criminals, for whatever reason, decided to use their breath to mock Jesus, to make fun of Jesus for being there. But what we also know is that at some point, one of the criminals sort of comes to his senses. He turns to Jesus at some point. We don't know exactly when. Somehow, some way, he comes to the realization that this Jesus, he's not just some criminal. No, no, no. No, this is the Christ. This is the man who is more than just the man. He actually is the Savior. He's the one that the Jews have been crying out that would be their Messiah, but for whatever reason, they turned on him. And that's when he says in Luke 23 to him, Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And what does it say again? Jesus answered him, "What? Forget it because you mocked me? No. Truly, I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise." two statements he made, utterly to demonstrate, my eyes are still not on myself. My eyes are still on you. It doesn't matter what I have to endure or what I have to do. My love for you is that great. This is what Jesus was saying from the cross. So he hung there. The Bible tells us as it goes on, it says darkness came from noon until 3. You know, right now there's just a little light outside. In about an hour or so, it's going to be pretty much dark. Imagine an hour from now. Imagine if that's what it was like at noon, all the way for 3 hours. And it wasn't because of some eclipse or anything. It was some supernatural darkness that came upon the land. But there it was, complete silence. It was utterly eerie. I could just picture it was like eerie. It says, but the silence, it was broken. And it was broken by none other than Jesus himself. Because it says that he cried out in a loud voice to heaven, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? What must that have sounded like? In the eeriness and then suddenly the cry of the Messiah calling out to heaven. It says he cried out. It's hard to really appreciate what the sound must have been like when we read in the English, he cried out. But it had to have been something that stunned the person who heard. It says he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? It was a moment in history, well, that the gospel records. It was the moment when God poured out the sins of the world on his son. And he, in utter agony, remember agony, he faced that moment. And that was the moment of punishment. That's when I believe it is that Jesus uttered these words. He cried them out. Peter actually wrote about Jesus in 1 Peter chapter 2. It says, he himself bore our sins on his body on the cross. The sins of the world poured out upon him. And Peter says, that's what happened. And then from the Old Testament, you know, in Habakkuk, here's what it says about God and sin. Your eyes, speaking of the Father, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. And you cannot tolerate wrongdoing. And so God had to turn away his face from his son at that moment because of the sins of the world being poured upon him. And Jesus' response was to agonize. Of course it would have been. See, to him, that was a fate worse than death. He who was God the Son, he who was holy, he who was pure, having to endure all of the unholiness. Can your mind even like fathom that? He was to endure all of that unholiness as a sin being poured upon him. Remember in the garden again, can I repeat that? In the garden, he begs the Father, if there is any other way. He weeps and he sweats blood. This isn't Jesus saying, well, you know, I'm going to follow a script. He says, because I foresee what's going to happen, Father, there's going to be that moment when I'm going to actually cry out that you are forsaking me. That's worse than anything death could bring. And that's the moment that we see right there. But he went through it. Not your will, not my will, but yours be done. And he went through it. And again, what did he show us as evidence from the cross? Where was his heart? It was on you. And it's on me. And it was worth it for the Lord still to endure what made him sweat blood. So soon after, Jesus cries out again from the cross, it is finished. It is finished. What was finished? I see four specific things for us to ponder. When Jesus says this, it is finished. Firstly, of course, his suffering.
His horrific suffering was finished. Jesus would never have to experience such agony, such brutal physical pain. He would never have to experience the brutality and agonizing feeling of being forsaken by his Father. It is finished. And then secondly, what would have been finished? Having to keep the perfect requirements of the law. Having to keep the requirements of God's law and to do so perfectly. It is finished. He said, that's finished. Now there's a new covenant here. There's something new that's going to come. Besides, no one could keep the law perfectly. No one could do it. You know, God didn't give us his commandments to show us how to become holy, how to become righteous. God gave us his commandments to show us that we couldn't do it and that we needed a savior. It's possible. I was looking at some pictures of some homes being decorated. And I remember real prominently a couple had in their living room this huge, it was a rendition of the Ten Commandments. It's huge in there. It like took up the whole wall practically. And it was stunning. It was really, really cool. You know, maybe you have Ten Commandments hung on your wall or, you know, on your office desk somewhere. I don't know. But one thing about them is this. You know you can't keep them, huh? I know I can't, not without God's help. As I've gotten into arguments or people have challenged me, I should say it that way. Raj, actually, you know what? I can keep all 10 of them. You know, that's kind of my religion, man. You're always preaching this Jesus thing. I've got my 10 commandments, and this is my religion right here. Every one of them, I've kept. Never murdered anybody. Never committed adultery. Been faithful to my spouse. And my response is, you know what? Good for you. Good. I'm glad that you can do that. But I just have to ask you some questions here. Have you ever disliked anybody? I mean, have you ever hated anybody in your whole life? Has there been anybody that you ever hated? And I remember he said, well, yeah. And I said, well, then listen, because according to Jesus, you're a murderer. Because to have hate in your heart is to be as a murderer. Have you ever looked at a woman with lust? Have you ever been attracted to a woman lustfully? And he said, well, I mean, yeah. And I said, well, then, according to Jesus, you've committed adultery after all. Because the heart is what matters when it comes to the Lord. And he was getting the point. And this is, of course, the point. For Jesus to have come along. You see, we can't keep the law. We can't keep the commandments. We are all guilty as charged. Some of you here, maybe you're here this evening and you've just heard me say something that you didn't know. Maybe you're actually here and you thought, well, I do keep the Ten Commandments. You know, I am a good guy, or I am a good gal. I am pretty good. Well, you heard what it is that Jesus did. He raised the bar. Sometimes I've said it like this. He raised the bar into heaven. Yeah, but Raj, I'm a pretty good person. You should see some of the other people around me. You ever heard that before? Yeah, maybe you've said it before. The Bible says this. That if you've broken even one point of the law, you are guilty of breaking them all. This is a standard called perfection. And see, this is why, can I get back to the beginning now, why we call Good Friday good? Through all of that whole narrative of the final week of Jesus' life, to the words that he utters from the cross, to what it is that he actually says to God, it is finished. He says, you know, why have you forsaken me? And then he goes to, it is finished. What he is saying is, it is finished. No longer such a burden to be laid upon them, because I will show them of myself the way. I am the way. I am giving my life in their stead. I'm dying for them, taking the punishment that they actually deserve. Father, give it to me, because when I go to the cross, I will willingly and lovingly die for them. It says in Colossians chapter 2, he canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. Those are pretty powerful words, aren't they? It is finished. Indeed, it was. So canceling sort of the righteous requirements there. And then number three, it is finished. Well, Jesus finished Satan's stronghold on humanity. The devil's stronghold on humanity. Because in the very next verse of Colossians 2, it says this: in this way, he disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. That's the evil, that's the darkness, that's the realm of the devil. It says he shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. It is finished. Hey, devil, your stronghold on humanity, it is finished. That's why none of you has to be a slave to sin, huh? That's why I don't have to be a slave to sin. It doesn't matter what that sin is. By God's power, it cannot enslave you. You don't have to be a slave to drugs or to alcohol. You don't have to be a slave to immoral behavior. You don't have to be a slave to hatred or just those things that, you know, weigh you down. You know those things that weigh you down from the spirit up? Jesus says, that's finished because of what I did on the cross for you. It is finished. Tetelestai. And then it was number four. I said there were four. Let me give you the fourth. What was finished was our salvation. What was finished was our salvation. Sort of a summary of all that we've said so far. I grew up in a home and I grew up in a culture with people who challenged me to be good. I grew up in a culture where people had a notion that you had to appease God. Make sure God thinks you're good. Make sure that what you do, and that could have been by lighting incense sticks and twirling them in a little circle in front of a statue. For some people, it could mean 3 days in the mountains with a guru. For others, it meant other things, and maybe you know, you have perhaps your own experiences with those people who say, look, the way to God is, and then they'll say, do this, be that, do the good, stop doing the bad, make sure it weighs more towards the good than it does the bad, and you're in. Some might say, no, it's not like that, and the fact is that Jesus opened the way fully, door wide open for you and for me at the cross. Why? Because it was sin that was the barrier. And Jesus' death is what paid for, is what took care of all of that sin. You've ever heard this saying before? Jesus paid a debt he did not owe because we owed a debt we could not pay. And this is what the truth of the cross is. God gave his son to die so that you and I didn't have to, because there is a debt that has to be paid in sin. It's a consequence, and that is death. We have a consequence for not being able to repay, and that consequence is death. And that's why Jesus had to die. John 3:16 says God loved the world so much that he gave his only son. You know the repayment of that debt? Sort of God taking out his wallet and saying, here's my son. Put it on my son. Oh, throw in 15% for yourself. No, but put it on my son. And Jesus willingly went. God loved the world so much that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him won't die but will have eternal life. There it is. That's it. Can I read that again? God loved the world so much that he gave his only son so that whoever believes in him won't die but will have eternal life. That's Christianity 101, John 3:16. And it was all for love. God's love for the world and God's love for everyone in it, including you and me. You know, he made you and he made me in his image, right? That's what the Bible says. How sweet is it? You're looking in the mirror. Don't you worry about your blemishes and your wrinkles. You look at yourself and say, I am looking at God. So to speak, you are made in the image of God. He created you and he created me to have a relationship with us, huh? He created us to have a meaningful purpose. He created us to have a personal and wonderful and meaningful relationship for all of eternity. This is amazing. This is why we call Friday good, even though, yeah, it was gruesome. And it doesn't happen with religion. Oh, I'm still dealing with people I love so much, and it's all about religion. No, it's about relationship. Because of what Jesus did on the cross 2,000 years ago on a Friday we call good. Because he died for you and he died for me, and that proved it once and for all. What an awesome truth, huh? How can we not but call this day good? Knowing all of the facts that I shared with you still, how can we not call this day good? And I love, by the way, in John 3:16, Christianity 101, you notice it doesn't say the rich who believe, the poor who believe in him will be saved, the Americans who believe in him, the Africans, the men, the women. It says whosoever believes in him won't die, but we'll have eternal life. God loves all equally. He desires all of us equally, doesn't he? Oh, what a great God he is. Whoever, whosoever won't die, but we'll have everlasting life. I don't know everybody here. As I was looking out, I know a lot of you just make me smile when I'm looking at you. So if I'm smiling a little too much, it's your fault. But there are some of you that I don't know. And I'm just kind of, I always wonder, I always pray, Lord, I've never seen him before. Does he believe this? I don't think I've ever seen her before. Does she think this is true? And I don't know all of you, and I'm just wondering, I'm asking that as a genuine question from the bottom of my heart. Do you know that this is true? And do you believe that this is true? Do you see why I can smile even after I gave such a horrific picture as what Jesus went through? Because what Jesus did was good. He looked at you and me and he said, it's worth it, I will do it. And I want to make sure that you know that and you believe it. Because I've been on the other side, so to speak. And I can tell you that's not a life that will make one smile. That will simply reinforce what? An emptiness of the soul. It will simply reinforce, it will simply confirm what I denied day in and day out, which was, I need something. And it doesn't matter how hard I try, it's not happening. And I tried it, and I worked it, and I thought I earned it, and I thought I did it, and it never happened. It's because God doesn't want you that way. He wants you to see the love that he has for you, and he wants you simply to accept it. He wants you to receive it. He wants you to believe it and receive it. If you're here tonight and you've never put your faith, if you've never put your faith, your trust in Jesus Christ, then I want you to know another thing, and this is actually making me smile about you. I know you're not here by coincidence. Oh, God loves you so much that even if your Aunt Mary dragged you here by the ear, God was in it somewhere. Okay, God, don't get mad at God, but just thank God because he got you here. Because there was something in this message that you just heard that sparked it. You know that? You know what I mean by that? It sparked it. Something happened. And this was what it was. You needed to know this truth about how much God loved you and why it was that Jesus went to the cross for you. And he's saying, won't you now receive? Won't you now believe and receive? Won't you have a new kind of peace that only I can offer? Did you know that that's what God promises you? The Bible says it's a peace. And you know how it's worded? It's a peace that surpasses all understanding. It's the coolest thing. It says it doesn't matter how hard you try to think about how great the peace is, you'll never grasp it. It's that great a peace. It says, yeah, that's what you get. How about joy? Man sakes, is joy just lacking in this world or what? True joy. I'm not talking about happiness, because happiness is based on circumstances, isn't it? Joy, that transcends happiness. Joy is kind of in you. And the Bible says that God gives you that joy. In fact, in Psalm 30, it says that that becomes sort of refreshed. It says it'll become new every morning. Who doesn't want that? What else? Well, I must say this. If you don't have Jesus, you remember there are consequences. You know, I mean, it sounds great to have peace because it is peace. And it is great to have joy because, oh, what joy. And to experience a connection like that, oh, what a connection. But you have to remember there is that side of it that is very, very serious. And that has to do with your eternal destiny. Where it is you go will be based on the decision you make when it comes to Jesus and his cross. It will absolutely and totally depend on you. You see, because the Bible does tell us, and this is why Jesus did it, that all are sinners. You know, it's the first part of becoming a Christian. You simply confess, I'm a sinner. The Bible says, I fall short of God's perfection. I promise you, I fall short of God's perfection. I am a sinner just like you are. And the Bible says that, well, there are those consequences for sin. And actually, the consequence is death. Okay, so you've heard the story. You've heard how it is that Jesus had the sins of the world poured upon him. You hear how it is that Jesus then died to repay that debt. But see, if your debt isn't repaid, then you got to pay it yourself. And that means your death. And the Bible says you don't just cease to exist. Now, we're spiritual creatures. We're spirit creatures. We exist forever. But the Bible says that death for those still in their sin, that's eternal separation from God. And eternal separation from God means hell. This is the place that God had created for Satan and his rebels. It wasn't a place that he had designed for the rebels of humanity, so to speak. But those who deny him, well, they're rebelling against him. And that is the place that they go. That is their punishment. That is their torment. And it does say it is eternal torment. And the Bible then tells you there is that one way that you can avoid it. But see, God doesn't want you to think about it that way. He doesn't say, avoid hell, come to Jesus. He says, have an eternal relationship with me, come to Jesus. Oh, and avoid hell. And this is what it's all about with Jesus. So if that's you, may I say one more time to you, you're not here by accident. Tonight, on this Good Friday, Jesus wants you to experience the good. Today is your day. Tonight, this evening, it's yours. The Bible says in Revelation 3, verse 20, would you look at the screen, please? Here's Jesus speaking. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. there will be a permanent intimacy. I want to have a relationship with you, and let me describe it like this: permanent, awesome intimacy. We will be connected in a way that is utterly joyful. Behold, he's standing at the door right now and knocking. Your heart, is that you tonight? Okay, here's what we're going to do, because we've come to an end of our evening service. And what I want to do is make an offer for you right now to answer the door. To reflect on very quickly, please, why Christians call this gruesome Friday Good Friday. To understand how it has everything to do with you. Just reflect on that in these 10 seconds. And then realize that you are a sinner. And realize that God has provided the way for your sin to be paid, so that you will have an eternal life with him. Okay, you got it. It's time. Here's what I'm going to ask everybody to do. Would you close your eyes, please? Bow your heads. For those of you who want to receive Jesus this evening, you now recognize you're a sinner. You recognize that Jesus died on the cross for your sin. He repaid the debt that you yourself could not repay. What you'll do next in just a moment is you're going to turn from your sin. You're going to turn from that way that is without God. You're going to repent. You're going to turn towards God now. You're going to receive Jesus as the Savior of your life. Savior means the one who saves. And it's a proclamation by faith. You're not going to work for it. You're to believe and receive. And the next thing you're going to do is you're going to entrust yourself to him. Oh, this is what we call the Lordship of Christ. It's why we call Jesus our Lord and our Savior. He's our master. He's the one we follow. And the Bible says that those of you who are in Christ, you are empowered by God the Holy Spirit. I am empowered by God the Holy Spirit. And I have been given that power in order to follow Jesus, to obey his commandments that he gives me in the Bible, to live the life worthy that he has called me to live, to be able to live it worthy in that manner, to be able to act like Jesus to this world that needs him so badly. You understand, this is a transformation from the inside out. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do now. Say this prayer after me. You can say it in your heart. Say it like this: God in heaven, I am just in awe of the love you have for me. I am in awe of why today is Good Friday. Jesus, I am so thankful that you went to that cross willingly. You took that beating and you shed your blood willingly because you love me. Jesus, tonight, I want to give my life to you. I confess that I am a sinner. And I repent of that sin. I turn from it. And I turn to you now. And by faith, I believe, Jesus, you are my Savior. I believe that you are the one who saves. I ask you to become the Savior of my life right now, please. Come into my heart and make my heart your home. I entrust my life to you. You, my Lord. You, my Master. Take reign of my heart. I am now yours forever, and I thank you for that relationship. I praise you, and I love you. I thank you for peace that passes all understanding. And I thank you for joy that will be refreshed anew morning by morning. Holy Spirit of God, fill me now. Use me to do great things for your kingdom. And I pray that in Jesus' name.